Hello, my name is Stuart Morgan, and today I will be presenting my final year project on reverse engineering the Hornibrook Bridge. My supervisor was Igor Chavez, and the current slides that I'm about to go through doesn't represent the facts of the University of Newcastle. It is my own technical assumptions and knowledge. So the Hornibrook Bridge was built in Bramble Bay, Queensland. This is a picture of it here. And this is a picture of it here in its current day form. So the bridge was opened in 1935 to vehicular traffic. And in 1979, it was closed to foot traffic only due to extensive deterioration of the timber roadway. And then in 2011, it was demolished. So the reason why this project is so important is because the cost of corrosion in Australia per year is estimated to about $30 billion by Curtin University in 2009. So this project basically started when the actual bridge was demolished in 2011 and the concrete reinforced piers were removed from the actual ground. When the piers were actually opened up, the extent of the concrete reinforcement was very, very minor compared to current literature, which says that it should have completely corroded away. So this is where the actual project started. So going into my actual project, this is what I knew. So I knew that there was isolated bar corrosion. There was no staining on the exterior of the piles. There was limited micro cracking. There was high chloride levels and there was large amounts of aggregates used, and the actual aggregates themselves were very large in diameter. And also there was seawater used in the initial mixture. Now current standards based off research undertaken in 1959 stated that the use of seawater in concrete reinforced structures would result in corrosion within 1 to 2 years. Evidently, this has not occurred, so this is an interesting point of my project. And that there was also measured acid sulfate soils recorded in the area. So this is another section of my report which I will comment on. So the project process basically went through an initial extensive review of literature. And based off that information, I then underwent experimental testing to reinforce and or challenge the current literature that exists. So the current causes of corrosion are basically chloride penetration and carbonation. So chloride penetration basically occurs when chlorides that exist in salt water penetrate the surface of the concrete structure and break down the passive layer which actually exists around the reinforcement which protects it from corrosion. So when this occurs, the chlorides get in, break down that layer and corrosion occurs. So that's the first major contributor which I had to investigate. The second was carbonation. So carbonation occurs when carbon dioxide penetrates through the surface and lowers the pH. So fresh concrete, the acidity level, the pH level, is basically between 11 and 13. So basically, once it gets below about 10.5, stating current literature, basically occurs, and carbonation actually just brings on corrosion. So that's basically the two main causes that I had to investigate. So looking into chloride levels, which obviously I just mentioned, in 2003, the chloride levels measured in the structure were between 0.6 and 3%. So reviewing this to current literature, the upper bound in terms of all current research standards states the upper bound is 1.96 per weight of cement. So in 2003, it was incredibly high above the maximum level. So the normal amount accepted is about 0.6%. So, you know, 3 is much, much, much higher. So potentially, the impact that chlorides have on an initiation of corrosion is potentially not as bad as what we currently think. So from this, I then went on to view how carbonation and chloride penetration actually occurs. So this, the main cause is through microcracking. So this bridge here is the Shark Creek Bridge, which is built near Grafton. So it was built in 1938. And it is a perfect example of an aged structure that basically shows no sign of deterioration. So just because a bridge is old doesn't mean that it has to necessarily deteriorate. So basically the only signs of deterioration were tensional cracks. So obviously, as we know, concrete is bad in tension, hence why we put internal reinforcement. So these cracks have occurred because the actual structure is a bowstring. So you have an arch with instead of having cables like in a suspension bridge, but in 1938 they used pre-tensioned concrete beams, which have obviously undergone tensional loading when the cars have actually gone over the top, caused some cracking. But besides this was the only example of cracking or actual deterioration, which is quite interesting. So through the review of literature based on the observations that I made, I actually found that the fatigue loading on a microstructure will result in a reduction to 55% of the original loading limits. So this lowers the flexural limits and the axial loading limits as well. So basically what this does is, as a bridge ages, its ability to undertake loads reduces, which results in more microcracking. And this then reduces the ability for the structure to resist chloride and carbon dioxide penetration. So other studies have shown that all you need is a 0.2 to 0.4 millimetre transverse crack to allow significant penetration of water, which is the main cause of how chlorides get in. So you only need minor deterioration of the concrete matrix for significant corrosion to occur. So this is interesting. So, as I previously mentioned, there has been a difference in the actual dynamic loading history. So this is a picture of the bridge here prior to its closure. This is when it was under usage as a footbridge. So as I said, it was opened in 1935, closed in 1979 to vehicular traffic and only for foot traffic usage only, and it was demolished in 2011. So the undertaking of a lowering of dynamic loads, such as the Hornibrook Bridge, is not uncommon. So a local bridge, which is shown here, so this is the Clarencetown Bridge. It's a heritage listed bridge. It's one of only about 24 wooden bridges that existed in 2004 across New South Wales, and it has a heritage significance to the area. So what they've actually done is they've reduced the width of the structure by putting a temporary Bailey Bridge, which you can see in the centre of the roadway, and they've reduced the speed. So what they've actually done is the exact same thing as what they did with the Hornibrook Bridge, is lowering service loads, which extends the life of the structure by lowering microcracking, basically the same concept. So actually plotting how deterioration occurs in terms of a probability of failure, the curve would normally go as that line just appeared. So you would normally have a smooth curve up as the bridge ages, but obviously over the course of a bridge's life, an increase in population and usage normally occurs, such as the Hornibrook, because it was built in, you know, the mid-30s. There's obviously a massive increase in population in Australia. So what it would actually teeter up. But as I said, in 1979, we've gone from a completely standard vehicular loading system to a footbridge. So much, much lower loads, less microcracking. Therefore, that might be the reason why it's lasted as long as it has. So for a visual interpretation, so I've just got two videos. So in 1930, we've obviously got vehicle loading, which is shown here. So as you can see, the trucks just going across, hitting that expansion joint there. And then in 1980, we've gone from this to this. So we've got foot traffic, so much, much lower loads, which is very, very important for my study. So viewing this bridge in Hexham, I then realised that the Hornibrook Bridge doesn't actually have expansion joints, where you can see that line has just actually appeared. So what expansion joints do is they actually allow a bridge to actually flex and not build up pressures at the actual joints. But because the Hornibrook had a timber top, you didn't have those expansions that a concrete or steel bridge would have, hence why you didn't need them. So what does an expansion joint actually do in terms of dynamic loading? So an average dynamic load, which is your ADR, is the average of your highest dynamic load and your lowest dynamic load. So basically point loading, say, a truck going across. So the average would go up 0.15, because what actually happens is the deterioration of the crack occurs and causes a bump. So for those of you that haven't experienced an expansion joint before, it's basically the ba-boom, ba-boom noise when you go across a bridge. That's what an expansion joint actually sounds like. So comparing that to the Hornibrook on the right, doesn't have an expansion joint. So although it's only gone up 0.05, it doesn't seem like very much, but over the course of the life of the structure, it makes a big difference. Okay, so from that, I then looked into how those loads actually transferred down. So expansion joints obviously occur where two beams intersect, which obviously tend to occur at the top of a column or a stockhead, which is located on the left here. So the bridge on the left is the Ash Owen Bridge at Hexham. So comparing the actual existing bearing capacity plates of the time, I noticed that that older bridges actually didn't have dampers. So dampers are normally constructed of a rubberized pad, which actually reduce or lower vibrational loading, which causes microcracking. So on the left, you can see a bridge that was built in about 1954, which has not had a damper, which has resulted in microcracking and extensive spalling, which you can see on the left. But the Hornibrook on the right, that didn't occur. Although that pier that you can see is a reproduction because the bridge was torn down, there are some of the existing piers which I inspected and they were in very, very good condition. Nothing like the bridge on the left. So the difference is that the bridge at Bramble Bay uses something called a corbel. So what the corbel actually does, it evenly distributes the load across the top of the pier, whereas the bridge on the left actually applies high point loads. So through doing a basic computer model, you can actually see the bridge on the left, you can see the point loads, which are in a dark blue. And on the right, you can see the Hornibrook Bridge, which has an even dark blue band running across the top, which means the load are evenly applied. So no point loads, less stress, less microcracking, less corrosion. That's basically it. So as I mentioned previously, the bridge actually had very, very large aggregates, which current standard state actually would result in corrosion. And these are the reasons why. So basically, a length of microcrack will actually increase with an increased diameter. And the width of a crack will also increase with an increased diameter. But what we're actually looking at is how wide a crack is. So it doesn't matter how long a crack is, it depends how wide it is in terms of how permeable it'll actually make the structure. So going off what current standards say, the actual matrix of the Hornibrook Bridge should have been very permeable, resulting in corrosion, but this hasn't been the case. Why is this so? Well, going into the comparison of existing building standards, say the AS3600 2009, which most current reinforced bridges are actually constructed from with supplementary add-ons, current standards actually use fly ash. So fly ash is a low-cost supplementary for fine aggregates, which is basically sand. And it wasn't utilised much on large scale into the mid-1950s. Basically, all current structures use this because it significantly reduces the cost of concrete. So what it actually does is, because it's so fine, it actually breaks up the actual structure and clogs the very, very fine pores that the original sand wouldn't do. So what it actually does is, in increasing amounts, it actually increases the time in which corrosion would initiate because it blocks up those pores. But comparing the microstructure of fly ash, which is shown on the left, to sand, which is shown on the right, you can see that fly ash is very, very round, whereas sand is very sharp and angular. What this actually does is, it enables a slight increase in compressive strength, which is good. But what it actually does is, the flexural tensile strength of lightweight concrete was around actually 80% of the conventional mix. This was undertaken by some researchers. And also the first microcrack will occur at 12.79% of the conventional mix. So this mix basically had a huge amounts of fly ash in it, which isn't conventional, but the actual breakdown of the study found, the main reason was because fly ash, the actual shearing, occurs at a much lower rate, which is important. So as I said, 12.79%. On the previous slide, I mentioned that fly ash is actually used to actually prevent corrosion, but corrosion occurs when microcracking occurs. So we're currently using it to prevent corrosion, but it actually creates corrosion by inducing microcracking. So, you know, it's a bit odd that we're actually using it, but that's up to the standards to decide. So I then looked into how high and low quality concretes actually affect chloride diffusion, which is obviously, as I said, one of the main reasons why corrosion occurs. So on the left here, we have a low and we have a high quality concrete. So this study actually found that a higher quality concrete will actually result in higher corrosion once water has actually penetrated. This is because it doesn't allow the water and the rust product to diffuse into the matrix of the concrete, which is shown on the top right, in the middle right here. You can see that the corrosion product has actually leached further into the actual structure, whereas on the base, it's very, very marginal. So what this would actually result in the high quality concrete is an actual shearing of the concrete matrix from the reinforcement bar through pumping when water actually gets inside. Whereas in low quality concrete, it actually enables the water to penetrate out into the matrix. So when the bridge was actually torn apart, although I said there was no corrosion, I lied for a second, there was actually one marginal small section. So this small section had only about 25% of its original diameter. So this is quite interesting, but whereas the rest of the structure was 100% okay. Basically what happened was, because the structure's quality of concrete was so high, what has happened is that there was a hairline crack. So most common types of corrosion is actually ferrous oxides, which is the most common type of staining which you see. Our studies have actually found that the type of corrosion that was in this structure was ferrous chlorides. Now, ferrous chlorides actually occur as little beads of, almost like little beads of water. And what has happened is when the water is penetrated through the surface of the concrete, that's actually washed out those ferrous chlorides and stopping it from actually building up and breaking away and spalling. So it's actually quite interesting that the different types of corrosion can occur in different situations. So this is the reason why the bridge actually lasted so long. When it actually had corrosion occur, it basically exited from the structure, not resulting in cracking and spalling. So the tidal zone situation. So tidal zones are considered to be one of the most aggressive environments. So this is the situation here. So below the waterline, or the maximum waterline, is where the high levels of corrosion occur. Directly above that is where severe corrosion occurs because you've got high amounts of oxygen. And then above that, you've got the moderate zone. So in terms of corrosion, the actual piers mimic this. So just above the waterline, there was spalling and cracking, but below the waterline, there was nothing. So as I said before, sulfates were present in the area. So I went up to Brisbane, I did my studies and came back, but once I got back, I realised through this statement here that the effect that it has is very, very minimal. So due to time and cost constraints, I actually didn't undertake the testing. Although current tests have shown from different departments that there is acid sulfates in the area, but for the purpose of my studies, I just discarded it for the moment. So the impact of workmanship. So this is the Hawkesbury River Bridge, which I inspected. It's currently in a bit of controversy as the Sydney Morning Herald released an article about its significant deterioration below the waterline. And this is an example of poor workmanship. So this area of spalling on the edge here, so I've just placed a hammer there for visual size purposes, so you can see actually how big it is. What's happened is there's been inadequate compaction on the edge of the actual pier, which has resulted in corrosion. So in terms of the Hornibrook Bridge, the actual oversee was very, very stringent in terms of how they built the bridge. So very, very stringent, and these sort of poor isolated areas haven't actually occurred, which is fantastic. So from this point here, I then left my literature and went to testing. So in total, I travelled over 4,000 kilometres, which I didn't expect to do, but I have completed, and it's been very, very beneficial in terms of studies, because most current research is based off short-term studies, whereas I've gone out and inspected long-term studies. So my data is actually currently, it has the capacity to challenge current standards, which is quite interesting. So I've waded through water in about 16 degrees. I've swum, I've worn yellow raincoats and swum again and climbed up on piers, all in the name of engineering and science to get some pretty interesting test data, actually. So I did this testing by using a Smith hammer. So a Smith hammer is a handheld device which allows you to actually measure the hardness of the exterior of a structure so that you can see me on the left using it. So what I actually did was I broke up bridges sections into good and bad, so areas of the exact same type of concrete. So on the top here, you can see an area where it's well, semi-decent, but below that you can see a vertical hairline crack running down, which would instate the fact that there is internal corrosion currently going on. So you test both areas, you get your results. The higher quality area where there hasn't been corrosion should return a higher result in terms of density, which was shown to be the case. So these are my results here. So in terms of the Smith hammer results, you can convert them into a compressive strength in MPa, which I have done for my actual report, but for this purposes of the presentation, I'm just going to leave it as a Smith hammer result. So number 23 was the Hornibrook bridge. So you can see here that in green, you've got the bad location, which is on the left, and on the right, you can see the Hornibrook bridge. These results were only about, what have you got, about five rebound numbers in difference. And across the board, most of them didn't have much of a difference in terms of good and bad location. So that shows that isolated areas of poor workmanship actually have a high influence in terms of a structure's deterioration over a long period of time. So actually observing my results, you can see that numbers 17, 18, and a few of the others actually don't have bad areas. So these test areas, we have either undergone extensive restoration, so they've patched up and they've actually removed the visible areas, or we physically couldn't get to them. And in one or two of the cases, there actually wasn't any deterioration, such as number 17 and number 10, which have very, very high results, which is good because we actually now know that a high rebound number means a high density, high compressive strength, which means that chlorides and carbonation shouldn't occur, which is what we expected to see. So the conclusions based off my entire study are as follows. So I now know that the change in usage over the lifetime of the structure has reduced microcracking. No expansion cracks has lowered microcracking as well, therefore less corrosion. The use of corbels, which are common in timber bridges, has reduced point loading across the headstocks, which has also reduced corrosion. Not using fly ash has also reduced corrosion, so potentially standards should consider not using fly ash in dynamically loaded concrete, but that's obviously up to these standards to actually determine. High quality concrete has limited the staining under tidal conditions, and seawater has actually a limited effect in the initiation of corrosion. So potentially, once again, that's something that the standard should consider changing. So basically, that's my entire project. Has anyone got any questions?